I'm Norman Wildberger. Today we're going to talk about arithmetic with Hindu-Arabic numbers. We're going to talk about addition, subtraction, and multiplication, and we'll have a few things to say that are quite interesting for primary school education. Let's start off with the simplest one, addition. Naively, we have two strings of ones, which are for us natural numbers. To add them, we just put them together in the obvious way. The second level of complexity is with Roman numerals, where we've peeled off some tens, which we write as x's. So we recognize this number as 10, 10, 1, that's 21, plus the other one, 15. And to add them with Roman numerals, we just put all the x's together, and we put all the ones together to give us 36. With Hindu-Arabic notation, we represent this by 21, two tens, and one one. This by 15, 1x, 110, and 5 ones. To add them, we can put them on top of each other like this, and when we add the ones and we add the tens, we get 36. So it gets a little bit more complicated if we have bigger numbers. So here is another example, which turns out to be this 16 plus 19. In Roman numerals, we put them together, we get two x's, two tens, and then we have a string of ones. But we have agreed with the Roman numeral notation that we're not going to allow 10 or more strings. Whenever we have 10 or more of a certain kind, we exchange it for a higher denomination. So here we have a string of ones, we peel off a 10 and replace it with another x. It's an exchange, and so we end up with xxx and 5 ones, that's 30. So how does it work in Hindu-Arabic notation? Well, we put the 16 on top of the 19, we add the 6 and 9, we get 15. And the corresponding thing here is to put 5 ones here and to peel the other 10 ones off and write it as a single 10. So we're adding one 10 to the tens column. And then we add the tens to get 3, so we have 35 altogether. Another example, same idea. Let's say we have 247 plus 385. We start with the ones. 7 plus 5 is 12, which we write as 2 ones and 1 10. Then all together the tens, we have 13 tens, which we write as 3 plus 10 tens. And the 10 10 is written as 100. Those are the hundreds column. And all together we have 600. And so we have 632 as the final answer. Now let's have a look at subtraction, the inverse operation to addition. If we have this number and we want to subtract this number, what it means is that effectively we're peeling off a number of ones just equal to the number there. So we're going to peel off these four ones and whatever we have left over is the final answer. In terms of Roman numerals, we have this minus this. And it's easy to see that this 7 ones minus 4 ones is 3 ones, so we end up with 13. In terms of Hindu-Arabic notation, 17 minus 4, we write 17 minus 4. 7 ones minus 4 ones is 3 ones, and 1 10 minus 0 tens is 1 10, so we get 13. That mimics what we're doing with the Roman numerals. Here's a more complicated example, where we have 34 minus 16. Now, to make that subtraction with Roman numerals, we can't quite do it because we have 4 ones and we need to subtract 6 ones. That doesn't work. So we change one of the tens here for 10 ones, giving us 14 ones, which we can then subtract 6 from, giving us 8 ones. And we have the 2 tens minus the 1 ten is a single 10. What we do with Hindu-Arabic notation is exactly parallel to this. So we write 34 minus 16. 4 minus 6 doesn't work, so we need to change one of our tens for 10 ones. So instead of having 3 tens, we now have 2 tens. Instead of having 4 ones, we now have 14 ones. The actual number that we've got hasn't changed, just the denominations that are involved have changed. But now 14 minus 6, that works, that gives us 8. And 2 minus 1 is 1. So we have 18 as the answer. And that corresponds to what happens in real life. If I have $34 and in 3 tens and 4 ones, and you come up and ask me for $16, then I'm going to have to change one of my tens for 10 ones, perhaps through some third party, in order to be able to peel off the right money for you. Now, last year, my daughter in school learned a different way of doing subtraction, which I do not approve of. This is the way she does subtraction. 34 minus 16. Okay, the 4 minus 6 doesn't work, so we're going to add 10 ones for 14. And then to compensate for that, instead of subtracting 1 10, we're going to subtract 2 10s. So 14 minus 6 is 8, and 3 minus 2 is 1. We get the same answer, but it's much less intuitively clear what's going on with this method, because it doesn't correspond to what we actually do in real life. If I have 34 and I want to give you 16, this corresponds to suddenly I get 10 more from somewhere and you take 10 more to compensate. That doesn't happen in real life. So it's a good example of where pure mathematicians can have something to say about primary school education. If your child is being taught this way, I don't think they're being taught the right way. Now let's have a look at multiplication. First thing that children have to do is to learn the multiplication table. So here's part of the usual table, and let's assume that we've memorized this, perhaps up to 10 by 10 or 12 by 12. I also remind you of a few of our basic laws. There's the associative law for multiplication, written in our abbreviated fashion. So AB just stands for A times B. And here are the two distributive laws that we've talked about before. And here is a fancier version of the distributive law, where we have one term with two numbers added up times another term with another two terms added together. The result is four different multiplications: A times C plus A times D plus B times C plus B times D. So that's a combination of these two distributive laws, and it's very important for understanding how we actually implement multiplication by hand. So let's see what happens if we multiply 234 times 3. 234 is really 2 times 100 plus 3 times 10 plus 4. When we multiply by 3, we're really using the distributive law. The 3 is multiplied by this term to give 600, and also by this term to give 90, and 3 times 4, this term gives 12. And then we have to add up those three things to give us 702. And by hand, what we do is we write 234 times 3, and then there are three separate multiplications that are really involved. 3 times 4 is 12. This 3 really represents 30. So 3 times that 30 is really 90. And this 2 represents 200, and 3 times 200 is 600. So there are three things to be added up. We add them up, columns, and that's a surefire and good way of teaching multiplication to students to begin with. Later on, if necessary and they're proficient, you can do this all in one step. But there is nothing embarrassing about just doing multiplication this way, step by step. That way you understand that the distributive law is really what's happening, and you have as many operations as you do terms here. Let's have a look at a slightly more complicated example, 56 times 37. This is an example where we're implicitly using this law here. So there's really four separate multiplications going on. 7 times 6 is 42. 7 times 5, well, this 5 represents 50. So 7 times 50 is 350. This 3 times 6, well, that's really 30 times 6, that's 180. And 30 times 50 is 1,500. So there's really those four separate multiplications, and then we add them all up using a bit of carry. 4, 5, 8, 17, so there's one that goes up there. Then 10, one that goes up there, and 2. So although better students can do this in two lines, there's nothing wrong with weaker students being taught this very surefire, methodical way of doing it. Next time, we're going to talk about the trickiest operation, which is, of course, division. And we're going to have some interesting things to say about long division. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.